By God's grace. It's a grace that's sufficient for us. It's a grace that covers our weaknesses, that allows us to be here on this beautiful morning, to come together as a church family and just worship His great name. So as we sing this song out, we just thank God this morning for His grace. Amen, church.
Your faithfulness, oh God. So glad you guys are here. Welcome to Calvary this morning. Why don't you guys take a second now and go ahead and shake some hands with people around you.
Waking hearts to life, yeah.
morning. Go ahead and finish up that last high five, hug, or handshake. Start making your way back to your seat. Then you can sit down, get comfortable. How are we doing today? Thumbs up. Good, good. I'm so glad you're here today. Thank you so much for joining us. We're so glad that you're with us today. If you're a guest and this is your very first time here, in front of you, there is a welcome card, unless you're in one of the front rows and they're behind you. Grab one of those welcome cards and fill it out. And whatever way you're leaving today, we have people here to meet you. If you're heading out this way, we have a table out front with some friends there. They'll greet you. They'll take that card from you, and they will give you a free gift. And if you head out this way, we also have people out at the gazebo for you as well. So if it's your very first time, make sure you fill out one of those cards, just a couple questions, and you will get a free T-shirt from us. So make sure you do that today, all right? So I have a couple of announcements for us today. First of all, if you are wanting to go to the Couples Valentine's Day potluck, which is coming up, it's coming up on Saturday, February 11th. It's from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. If you want to be a part of that, you want to go to that, on the patio today, we're going to have Heather Coleman will be out there. She'll be taking sign-ups for that. So make sure you find her, and you can sign up to be a part of that, all right? Also, next Sunday is our first party on the patio. So yeah, so make sure that you're there for that. It's going to be great. We're going to have treats and photo booths and all sorts of fun things. So make sure that you come out to that next Sunday. Also, all of you have these pink things in your flyers, yes? This is so you can order cake pops. They're delicious. It's our children's ministry that puts them together. So make sure you fill one of these out. You can take it to Tiffany, or you can email her the numbers on her emails on the other side. You can email to get some of those. It helps raise money for our children's ministry. And the next thing that's coming up that I wanted to remind you guys about, too, is that we have winter camp for our student ministries. So middle school and high school, we're sending them to winter camp this year. It's fantastic. It's only $40 a student. Isn't that incredible? It's going to be amazing. So we're really hoping to just fill up those cabins and get as many teens there as possible. So you just have to go to calvarybellflower.org/events and you sign them up. It's under winter camp. Click on that, sign them up so that they can be there, okay? And make sure that they go. $40. Come on, they get a whole weekend, and it's going to be amazing. So make sure that you sign them up for that. Yes? Wonderful. All right, let's welcome up Pastor.
All right. Thank you. I don't need that right now. How are you guys doing today? Woo! Super Bowl Sunday. The two teams I predicted would be in there are out, so, you know. Alan Morris is really mad at me, you know, but he'll get over it. He has to. He runs the recovery ministry, okay? So, all right. Anyways, I'm a little nervous. I'm looking for buckets of Gatorade. I saw something on Facebook. I just want to make sure. So I'm trying not to make any good points today, all right? So we'll do that. I'm really excited about what's going to happen today because we're going to do, during the year, we're going to have about four of kind of a special missions emphasis Sundays, and today is the first one. Okay, so what we want to do is, you know, we as a church raise money for missions all year long, but then at the end of the year, we raise an amount of money for special projects that we do. And so I think this last year we raised over $100,000, something like that, right? No biggie. No, it was awesome, right? So yesterday, Pastor Jonathan and Ashley and a team of people, Jeff Braden took the shuttle bus and took a group of people up to Camp Pondo, and we gave them a check for $10,000 from that Christmas missions offering. So yeah, that's awesome. And what's the fun part is actually sending this money out to these different projects and different groups, and it's been a lot of fun with that. So it's awesome to raise it, but to give it and see how God's going to use this to change lives all over the world is amazing. So when we give to missions, we give all year, and on your giving envelope, if you have a giving envelope, there's a place on here that says mission support. So I want to challenge you guys during the year to give something to that mission support. Now that mission support, when you give to that, that is not Christmas missions. That's not our special projects that we have for Christmas missions. But it goes to support 14 missionary families that we have on different fields throughout the year. So we send them support through for this year, and that's what that is for. So when you give the mission support, that goes to the regularly supported missionaries that we have on the field, okay? So I want to challenge myself and you during the year to take that up a notch. You know, maybe if you could just say, man, I'm going to challenge myself to give $10 a week to missions. And I'll tell you what will happen with that. If we do that during the year, by the time we get to Christmas missions, we'll have already raised about $40,000 for those regularly supported missionaries, okay? So $10 a week, $5 a week, whatever it is, kind of if you think of the red envelopes again, but we're not going to use the red envelopes. We're just going to use the little white envelopes and give to missions throughout the year. So today and then three other times during the year, we're going to emphasize missions giving throughout the year to kind of take that up a notch. Okay, you guys with me on that? Okay. Still awake, right? Okay. All right. So to emphasize that today, I'm going to have two special guests with us. And first one, I'm going to bring Chrissy Berkey on up. And, you know, Cody, if you want to come up, you can bring your Kingdom Causes Bellflower. This is the team that works with Kingdom Causes. There you go. And I invited Chrissy to come today to be a part of this, let you guys know kind of what's going on with Kingdom Causes, but then present them with a check from our Christmas Missions offering. So Chrissy, why don't you tell us a little bit about Kingdom Causes for people that kind of don't know.
So before I jump in, I just, during worship, the scripture came to my head, and it's Isaiah 58:10-11. It says, "And if you spend yourself on behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness and your night will become like the noonday sun." And that's something that I think about this congregation specifically. This is a church where you guys do spend yourself on behalf of the needy. And that is such a blessing to us at Kingdom Causes. Kingdom Causes got started to be a partner with the many churches in Bellflower to really work together, harness all of our potential and the passion that Jesus gave us to care for others in our city, to make an impact in some of the bigger causes that are too big for one church to address. But Calvary Baptist has just been just a rock for us in the ministry. You guys have been a partner with the Saturday morning breakfast and all the people that are regulars there from your congregation. And the other thing about this church, and then I'll talk a little bit more about Kingdom Causes, is that this is a church for the people. And what I see over and over again is as we're working with people who are coming out of some pretty crazy situations, they feel at home here, and this is often part of their recovery. And so I'm just really blessed by this congregation and your leadership here. And is Alan not up here? Alan Morse? You're hiding. He's our board member. You guys should all know that. Give him some flack for that. All right. On our team, we have Dana, we have Jean, and Jason. Dana works with our homeless services. Last year, we housed about 100, well, actually, up to this year, we've housed about 100 people in the last year. And those are 100 neighbors in Bellflower and the surrounding communities. And those are people that we're not just saying, like, here's a handout, good luck, you're on your own. We're trying to partner them with churches so they really have a community. And our hope for our homeless neighbors is not that we just get a roof over their head, but that there's a way to get them back giving to the community and becoming contributing members who volunteer and who are upright citizens. And what we've seen is sometimes the homeless neighbors that we've housed, sometimes they're more generous than we are when they get a little bit of stability. So Dana, you guys should pray for her because she is constantly driving people back and forth and she's in the trenches. And so this is Dana. You guys know Dana. Jean and Jason. Jean, how many of you guys know about Good Soil Industries? Right? Good Soil, I mean, I'm not supposed to have favorites. on our programs, but Good Soil is probably my favorite program at Kingdom Causes, because as we were doing homeless ministry in your church gymnasium 10 years ago, we realized that, hey, sometimes people need more than food. We actually know quite a few people that want to work. They want to work their way out of poverty. They don't want a handout. But sometimes it's hard to get a job if you have a record or if you don't have a resume and things like that. So we started Good Soil 10 years ago. And what that does is we hire people who are hard to hire with our landscaping company. And it's a hot mess sometimes. It's hard. We have 100 customers, and we're constantly training people. But Gene has been a route manager with us for over a year. Well, gosh, 3 years. He's been a route manager for about 2 years with us. And so pray for Gene, because he's out in the field trying to keep customers happy and trying to train the guys. And then you guys all know Jason. Jason Barnett is our director of Good Soil Industries. And pray for him. He's like constantly, and he has such a big heart. So I think one of the things I admire most about Jason is he's constantly trying to think of the business side to keep things going. But he's also, man, if one of our guys like slips and goes away, his heart breaks. And I love that about our team, that they're not so hardened that they don't hurt when somebody slips and somebody relapses and goes back to jail or something. So pray for Jason. Pray for us this next year. We are really, really trying to expand our workforce development, because if somebody wants a job, we know that sometimes that job and that stability is what could keep them housed. It's often for the guys that we're working with what helps them get their kids out of the system. And that's huge, because if we're able to do that, we might be preventing homelessness for the next population or the next generation. So I love that the church is involved with that. That makes me happy that the church is in the business of doing that. And so we are just so grateful for you guys. If you ever want to get involved, please let any one of us know, because Kingdom Causes is not supposed to be an island. We want to be a tool for you guys, everybody sitting in the pews, to learn how to be a better neighbor, how to get involved with some of these people we're working with, and how to make a difference in Bellflower. So thank you so much.
Okay, it's amazing. So Gene, they do our yard. Good Soil does our yard. They do an awesome job. So they do the churchyard here. So, I mean, awesome to see the connections and grow in that, and we love it. So on behalf of Calvary Baptist Church, people that have given and sacrificed and pray for you guys, and thank you for letting us know specifically how to pray too, we want to present you guys with a check for $5,000 for Kingdom Causes. Awesome. Okay.
Just one more. So, Cindy, if you guys ever do call us, I just saw one more staff member that's here. Cindy, stand up and say hi. Cindy works the front desk.
Oh, yeah.
So please pray for her, because she also is our first line. If somebody comes into our office or calls, you're talking with Cindy. And so pray for her, because she's constantly on the forefront of what we're doing. So, sorry, you shouldn't give me the mic anymore.
Okay, give me that mic. Okay. No, awesome. Okay, you guys have a seat.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Keep up the great work. All right, so when we think of missions, it's not just going to another country or sending money somewhere else. It's about our community. You know, we want to be missional as a church and reach into our community, not just reach around the world, but change the world right here. And so Kingdom Causes is one of the ways that we get to do that locally and be involved in that. Another one that we get to do that with today, so I invited Chris Untie. Chris, come on up. Chris works for Habitat for Humanity. How many of you guys have heard of that? Habitat for Humanity? He actually brought a hard hat today. Wow, that's pretty awesome. So, I got to meet Chris through the Bellflower Ministers Association, and they have, Habitat has started a build here in Bellflower. It's already going, and I wanted him to come today and tell us a little bit about Habitat and how we as a church can get more involved right here in our community missionally with them. So let's give Chris another hand and let him go for it. Come on over here.
Pastor Kent, good morning, everybody.
Woo!
It's so great to be here today. Pastor Ken, thank you so much for the invitation to this incredible church. It's such an honor to be part of your services today. I also want to send a special shout out to Kingdom Causes and Chrissy and her entire team. A little over a year ago, we got a call from Kingdom Causes. And we sat down, and we had a meeting, and they let us know that they had this piece of land in Bellflower, and they were wondering maybe if Habitat, who had just moved our LA offices to the city of Bellflower a little while ago, maybe if they wanted to build some homes on it. So we had an exploratory conversation and met with the city council, and sure enough, as of today, we've just started building 6 new homes on Ramona Street right here in Bellflower. It's a true testament, I think, to what can happen when two or more come together to really demonstrate the love and teachings of Jesus and take that love out into our community, into our world. It reminds me a bit of two fellow Georgians. You might think I'm talking about President and Mrs. Carter, who are still our most famous volunteers with Habitat. But I'm also I'm actually talking about Habitat's founders, Millard and Linda Fuller, who 41 years ago had all the riches they could possibly want. They were millionaires by the time they were 30. They had, you know, all the material success that they could have imagined, but their marriage was really falling apart. And so they were, you know, thinking about separating, about, you know, ending it, but they were in New York City, and they walked by St. Patrick's Cathedral, actually, went inside and said, all right, we're going to give this one more shot. So they prayed that day. They met with a church back in Georgia soon after, and they sent them on a missions trip to Africa, where they saw communities coming together to build homes. And they were inspired, and they thought, maybe we should go back to the United States and try to do this in Georgia and see what happens. And so they did. And they went back to Georgia, and they said, we're going to start this housing organization to bring communities together, to demonstrate the love and teachings of Jesus, and to help families in need of a hand up to become a homeowner. Because they planted that seed 41 years ago, Habitat today is in 70 countries, in 50 states, and has served over 1.2 million families in need of a home somewhere in the world. I get emotional thinking about that, because imagine each one of us has that ability, right, to get up every day and go out into our world and make a tangible impact that will ever change the lives of so many families in need. And this year, we get to bring that to Bellflower. To know that 6 families that have been selected, that are working hard, but just don't have enough income to be able to achieve that dream of home ownership, but by putting in what we call sweat equity hours to help build their home. By paying back, we call it the Bible finance plan once it's completed, which is a great, amazing way to still have them pay back a portion of the mortgage, but not have to worry about the extremely high costs of housing along the way. To team up with families like that, and to team up with not only Calvary Baptist, but the entire church community here in Bellflower this year. What a journey it's going to be. I hope you might consider joining us. Habitat is based primarily on getting volunteers out to our build sites to help build the homes. And I know a few times throughout the year we're going to be rallying Calvary Baptist and other churches together to help build the homes. And don't worry if you don't have any skills. We have trained construction leaders out there that will guide you through every step of the way. But with that, Calvary Baptist, I again just want to thank you so much for having me here today and letting me be a part of your journey as a church this year. After services, I'll be around to answer questions, pass out info, and hopefully sign some volunteers up. But just remember, you know, if this great church, if Kingdom Causes, if Habitat, the more we can come together, what an incredible difference that we can make, just as Millard and Linda Fuller did. And just as Jesus called us to do, he told us that greater things are yet to come so many years ago, and this year we get a chance to make that happen. Thank you so much, and God's blessings to you.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, so as Chris said, we're going to actually have we're going to be talking to him about doing some Calvary Baptist build days. So we'll take a team of people over on a Saturday, for instance, and spend all day just working on those homes. And how many of you guys really don't have any skills with hammers and nails and those kinds of things? Raise your hand, Alan Morse. Okay, so it's okay. We can show up and just do what we're called to do. They'll have people bring food. You know, we can have people bring food, water, those kinds of things. So we'll have some build days coming up. So during the year, we're going to be doing the mission work here with that locally. And that's going to be a lot of fun and exciting, and to see those families move into those homes at the end of the year. Plus, we're going to take Habitat on as a Christmas missions project this year. You guys okay with that? So, awesome. So we'll be talking about, raising that $200,000 this year and how we're going to do that. I'm kidding, okay? All right. Okay, so maybe not. We want to definitely pray for God to use us as His church, right? To reach our community for Jesus. And as a church, we want to be mission-minded. It's not about building a museum. It's about being on mission with God. And so we want to continue that. So I've given you plenty of time to take that white envelope in front of you and write some missions money on there. But even if you haven't, you can do that online too. But let's kind of take it up a notch with our missions giving throughout the year. And guys, thank you so much for being so faithful and generous with regular giving, giving to missions, everything. It's amazing to be part of a generous family. So I want to go ahead and pray and pray for our offering. I know I've given you a lot today to think about, but let's stay on it. So I'm going to pray. And if you're going to help with the offering, go ahead and take your place. And at the first part of the offering, we've got a little video from Habitat. There's a pastor, I think, downtown L.A., Erwin McManus, has kind of given a little testimony about being involved with Habitat. So we're going to watch that, and then the band will come back up and lead us through more worship. So let's pray. God, we want to thank you for the blessing of being in a relationship with you. God, you love us. You are a giving God. You are a provider. God, you are the one who challenges us to trust you in a deeper way. God, you meet our needs on a daily basis. Even when we can't see how that need is going to be met, God, you meet those needs, and we thank you for that. And today we gather to worship you. God, worship isn't just about us singing or being together. It's about giving. God, it's about listening. It's about doing what you called us to do. So we pray your blessing upon Kingdom Causes here in Bellflower, God. We pray that you would keep your hand upon Chrissy and the team and just all the things that they're involved in. God, help us as a church to be mobile with them. God, we pray for Habitat for Humanity. We pray for Chris and just his leadership with the organization and what's going on with that. God, I pray that you would bless them and continue to move us to get involved in that, God, however you want us to. God, we pray that you would take this offering and just use it for your kingdom purposes. In Jesus' name, amen.
The scriptures talk about that the people who become the agents of God restore the cities and they restore the streets and they become the repairers of the breach. And there's something transcendent about doing something so practical. There's something happens inside of us that is eternal when we alleviate just a little bit of suffering in the world, even just for a moment. And when you walk down the street and you see so many people with incredible joy and a deep sense of fulfillment, making other people's lives better. For me, who didn't grow up in faith, and I didn't grow up in this world of Christianity, it is one of the few things that makes my faith feel real. There's so much proof of all that's not real. There's so much empirical evidence of things that are just messed up. And when you have a moment, you go, oh, this is what it looks like to see God. This is what it looks like to connect to the eternal. This is what it looks like to have your soul brought alive by the God who created you. That for me is a part of the beauty of it. So I don't know what I would say to all the people who live here except thank you, that you create an opportunity for those who have the resources to do something that matters in the world. Yeah, it's it matters what we do in this life. And that's why I love the people at Habitat for Humanity, because they could be doing so many other things, but instead they're just making the world better.
Well, yeah, man, that's what it's all about. It's about showing love and serving our community here where we are. A wise professor that we knew once asked us, if your church left and was taken out of the community, would they notice? You know, I'm not talking about the building, like, okay, where'd that big red brick building go? But would there be a negative impact to our community if we all left? Would they be asking, where'd those people go that used to love us and serve us? If there's a question in your mind about that, think about that. What we're doing, get involved with this Habitat for Humanity project, get involved with Kingdom Causes, but see what you can do in this community to show love, to show service. And that's what we're called to do as Christians, is, if anything else, to show love to our community. So this is where God has put us. So let's do it, right? Yeah? All right, why don't you guys stand as we continue with worship this morning.
Never. out, church. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
His holy name.
worship your holy name in this place, Lord.
God, your name that is above all other names, God. We recognize the power in your name. We recognize the grace in your name, God. But we are grateful to come together as church. God, as a church of freedom and worship your name today, God. We pray that you'd speak to us now, that you'll continue to move in this place, God. We just thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right. Have a seat. Thank you. Man, you guys sound awesome today. Well, really good. So, let's see. I was thinking about, there was a guy that posted that he had Super Bowl tickets for today, and he paid about $1,700 for the tickets, and then he realized that he had, when he bought the tickets, that that was the same day as his wedding. So he wasn't going to be able to go, so he put this ad on Facebook. He said, if you're interested and would like to go in my place, it's at St. Peter's Church in New York City, 5 p.m. Her name is Nancy. She's 5'4", about 115 pounds. Good cook, makes about $90,000 a year. She'll be the one in the white dress, okay? So obviously this guy has his priorities mixed up, right? But hey, if you got your priorities straight, you want to come to the Super Bowl party today, Super Plate Party, 3 o'clock, right? 3 o'clock today, high school room. It's going to be awesome. We'll have a lot of fun, but that's going to be good. So somebody asked me, who am I rooting for? I'm like, I don't know. Alan's still mad at me. I'll figure it out. Okay. So, all right. Mark chapter 6. We are in Mark chapter 6. We're doing this breakthrough series, and we're in Mark a chapter a week. We're chapter 6. Hopefully you're taking the handout, the outline that we give you, and you can either on your own or even better work with a group during the week and do the daily devotional that goes with it. And hopefully, because obviously I'm not going to be able to give you everything, but as you look through the chapter, there's a lot of stuff in here, especially today, chapter 6. I'm just trying to see what's the connection here with this breakthrough series. And today we're going to talk about breaking through some things, breaking through some of the fears that we have, but breaking through rejection, loss, and our human limitations. So we're going to break through that. Now, our key verse has been Mark 10:45 that says, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, and I love this, that we're talking about this today, not to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many. So it's about giving and serving, and Mark presents Jesus as the servant of God, and so he came to serve. And so the idea, though, is that today, as we look at this particular chapter, that sometimes, and I believe a lot of times, following Jesus can get a little scary and hairy for us, okay? So following Jesus, anybody with me on that? Like following Jesus, you're going to really follow Jesus, all of a sudden it gets a little scary because he's going to do some things that we weren't expecting or take us in a direction that we don't really want to go. And I call that kind of the breakthrough today. We're going to talk about how to break through some of those things. And three of our biggest, I think biggest and hairiest fears that we face deal with rejection and loss and limitations. For instance, what if someone doesn't like me or accept me? What if someone doesn't like me or accept me? What if that or they are taken from me and I lose that? What will happen? What if I'm not enough? What if I'm not enough? What if I don't have enough talent? What if I don't have enough strength? What if I don't have enough money? What if I don't have enough creativity or intelligence or courage to handle what life throws at me? What if I don't measure up? I don't feel like I measure up. I don't have enough. The key in following Jesus is to realize that's okay. He's enough. You don't have to have it all figured out. Anybody got it all figured out? No. We just did 101. And we had 11 new people in our 101 class. I was thrilled with that. And I said, man, this is like a family. We're a family. And again, how many of you grew up in a family? They all raised their hand. I said, how many of you had a perfect family? And none of them raised their hand, right? And I said, good, because this church is a family, and we're not a perfect family. So if you're looking for the perfect family, we ain't it. And if you're looking for one and you find it, don't join it, because you're going to mess it up, okay? So... But when we think about we're going to have to learn in following Jesus that he's going to take us into these breakthrough things, like not just breakthrough moments or minutes, but like breakthrough things in our lives that are holding us captive, like things that keep us stuck. Like he wants to break us through that, right? Like, and usually those are what I call fears. I'm afraid of that. So to think of what's that big fear that I'm facing and I'm feeling. Now, feeling the fear isn't wrong. It's an emotion. We all feel fear. But it's not moving forward in the midst of that fear. People are brave not because they don't feel fear. It's because they feel it and do it anyways. That's bravery. That's courage, right? So how do we break through those fears? So Mark chapter 6, I believe, like hits on these three. And I'm going to have to fly through this today. But it really nails down. I see these three areas that Jesus kind of breaks us through. And he's involved in it, okay? So Mark chapter 6, starting in verse 1. I'm just going to read the first section, and then we're going to talk through these three fears, okay? So Mark chapter 6, starting in verse 1. Jesus, it says, he went from there and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. And on the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished, saying, "Where did this man get these things? What is this wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands?" Sounds awesome, right? Wow, where did he get this? Then verse 3, it says, "Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us?" And it says, they took offense at him in his hometown. Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and among his relatives and in his own household. And he could do no mighty work there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he, Jesus, marveled or was amazed because of their unbelief. And he went among the villages teaching." We're going to stop there and address the first fear. It's really following Jesus makes you face your fear of rejection. Your fear of rejection. Anybody ever feel that? The fear of rejection? Like, nobody wants to be rejected. I feel it with my grandkids when I say, "Oh, come to Papa." They're like, "No." You know, that's like, tears me up. But the fear of rejection, Jesus is saying he's out preaching in around the Sea of Galilee and around the Capernaum area, and he goes to his hometown, which is up in the hills in Nazareth. And he goes to this hometown. Now, this is not the first time he's been home since he started his public ministry. The first time he went, they actually taught in the synagogue. In Luke chapter 4, you can read about this, where he taught in the synagogue, and they got so upset because he basically said, "I'm the Messiah," that they wanted to push him off a cliff and kill him. What a hometown welcome, okay? But he goes back. So he goes back into Nazareth, and he begins to teach again in the synagogue. And so it's kind of a second chance for a faith response to Jesus. And in the midst of this, they hear, they're amazed at his teaching. And the word amazed here means to strike out of one's senses, like being struck with a blow or being totally stunned or shocked. They were amazed. Like it's like, whoa, how does this guy know all this? How does he, and the work he can do, and what we're hearing about, what's happening in his ministry, this is amazing. And they begin to realize, this is that little kid Jesus, right? He grew up here. Isn't he the carpenter? Isn't he the son of Mary? Now, you don't really see this in the text here, but this is kind of a derogatory statement toward Jesus. The carpenter, the son of Mary. What about Joseph? Did they know Joseph? Yeah, they did. Joseph was probably dead at this time, so he's not really mentioned in the story in the gospel, but he's probably gone on to be with the Lord at that time, but they don't mention Joseph. Now, they know Joseph, but what are they thinking? Isn't this the son of Mary? That kid that was born illegitimately? Yeah, we heard she was a virgin, right? But in that town, That's kind of the, you see this implied through this, that the town people, as they listened to his teaching, they thought, this is awesome, but that's Jesus. I mean, we know this guy. He grew up here. We know his family. You see his brothers and sisters are mentioned. Jesus was not the only child, okay? So there were other children. I know you'd hate to be the younger sibling of Jesus, though, wouldn't you? Why can't you be like your brother? You're their favorite. But it says they were offended. So first they were amazed, and then as they begin to think about it, they were offended. And the word offended here is the word scandalizo, which we get scandal. And it means to deliberately place a hazard in the path of another to cause injury or even death. And it means that they were stumbling over the true identity of Jesus. Like they were offended. It means that they thought, no, this can't be. And it's really Mark basically saying here that they were making a moral decision to reject Jesus as the Savior, Messiah. Now, Jesus was obviously amazed at this. Of course, in the New Testament, a couple times, like 1 Corinthians 1 and 1 Peter 2, it talks about Jesus as the cornerstone and the stone of stumbling. But he's amazed by this sense of rejection. And so he tells them, he says, hey, a prophet is honored everywhere except in his own hometown. Now, this verse scared me to death when we were thinking about coming back to Bellflower. I was like, yeah, I don't know. Hometown, coming back. But it says, except in his own hometown, among his relatives and his own family. And because of their unbelief. So, and it says Jesus was amazed or astonished at their unbelief. And it resulted in him not doing a ton of miracles there. Now, it wasn't because they didn't believe that kind of stunted Jesus' ability to do powerful things. Okay? It was the fact that he chose, based on their unbelief, not to do powerful things among them. They didn't keep him. In a sense, they didn't curtail his power. He chose, because of their unbelief, and this is, again, their second time through this, that they're making a decision now to reject Jesus. Now, of course, this amazes Jesus. And the word here really is the idea that when we see that word amazed in the Bible, it's really connected to God doing something miraculous, something supernatural. And when you see God do something supernatural, you say, oh, God is what? Amazing. That's awesome. Like, God did that. Mark's actually using the word, kind of flipping the way it's used here, and saying that God, in response to their faithlessness, is going, that's amazing. Like, I show up there, I speak to them, I minister to them. I do many mighty works in front of them and with them and all around them. And they don't believe it's me. It's like me saying, I hear God's voice. This is this word. I read it. But I'm just choosing not to believe that God loves me or that God has a plan for my life. That's amazing to God. Like, why would you not believe that? That's what that's talking about. So Jesus understood rejection. I mean, he was a person that was rejected by many, right? Despised and rejected. So he understands rejection and the feeling of the rejection. He also mentions, Mark mentions a couple more things in the chapter here, and I'm not going to go further into, but the apostles, Jesus actually talked to the apostles about facing rejection. He sends them out, and he's like, hey, when you go out, stay at this place, and if the people reject you, shake the dust off your feet, which is basically like, get over it and move on, right? Don't let their rejection, like, stop you or keep you from doing what God's calling you to do. Just shake the dust off your feet and keep moving. Like, don't let rejection stop you, right? And then he goes on in the chapter, Mark talks about Herod. And Herod, King Herod at this time, was this crazy dude. I mean, there's a lot of stuff about King Herod. Very, like, wanted to be, he was controlling, maniacal king. And he wanted to be in charge of everything and control everything. And he begins to hear about Jesus doing all these miracles. And it says in Mark chapter 6 here that he begins to think, well, maybe this is John the Baptist. And then Mark explains that, why he thought it was John the Baptist. Well, because John the Baptist, King Herod, had had him beheaded. And Herod was thinking, well, maybe this is John the Baptist come back to life and doing all these miracles, because he was intrigued and really liked John the Baptist. But because of his fear of rejection, he had to have John the Baptist beheaded. And there's a lot in that. You can study more of that this week. But because of his fear of rejection, it says the king deeply regretted what he had said, but because of the vows he had made in front of his guests, he couldn't refuse. So he immediately sent an executioner to the prison to cut off John's head and bring it to him. I put Proverbs 29:25 in here. It says, fearing people is a dangerous trap, but trusting the Lord means safety. When we think about this first fear, breaking through this fear of rejection, let me just say this. Jesus, if you think about it, lived the only perfect life, and yet he was rejected by many, many people. Right? Jesus perfect, lots of rejected, you know, responses. If you think you're going to do better than that, you're kidding yourself. Right? None of us are anywhere near able to do things perfectly, say the right things, you know, do the right thing, all those things, right? We're going to be rejected. It doesn't matter if you do the right things or the wrong things. People are not going to like it, right? So basically, it's like you got to get over that, because being rejected doesn't mean you're a reject. But being rejected may be putting you in the place where God will really reward you for being faithful. So I'm speaking to myself big time on this one. That for many years, man, I don't want to be the senior pastor. I like being on the staff, because then I can say, well, here's what I think you should do. And then it doesn't work. I'm like, hey, it's a pastor. I mean, dumb idea. I don't want to be the pastor. But God had to do a work in my own heart and mind to realize that, you know what, it doesn't really matter what you do. They're just people that aren't going to like it. You know, there are people that actually don't like me. I don't get that. Why would you not like me? One of my daughters actually said something about, you know, Dad, it would be really hard to come to Calvary because I would hate to hear something negative about you. I'm like, why would anyone say anything negative about me? You know. But, you know, you have to make decisions. I mean, you, right? I think of athletes. You think of athletes. I mean, these guys that are, these women and men that are incredible athletes. You know what they've had to endure all of their life? Rejection. You know where that rejection comes from? The fans of the opposing team. Right? I mean, can you stand up against the day after day, like people yelling stuff at you, like, you suck. People like threats and stuff like that, right? You think these women and men are making like a lot of money because they're really good at what they do. And yet we can sit in the stands and go, you suck. Yeah, really? Yeah. Go get that, okay? I mean, really, that's kind of the culture we live in, right? If you're on the opposing team, you're going to get ragged on. You're going to get rejection. And guess what? We're on the opposing team as Christians on this planet. Right? We're on the winning team. I want to let you know that. We are on the winning team, right? But we are on the opposing team. We are going opposite direction from the world. We are going in the different direction that Satan wants us to go. So guess what's going to happen? We are going to be despised and rejected. If you think that you're going to follow Jesus and everything's going to be rosy, you are on the wrong path and you're thinking crazy and you need to come to Celebrate Recovery on Friday night and work out with me, okay? Like, it's just, you know, rejection. You got to get through that. Break through that rejection, that fear of rejection. The second thing is the fear of loss. The fear of loss. As you think about, and this one I'm really not going to spend a whole lot of time on, but it says, when John's disciples heard what had happened, when he had gotten beheaded, when John's disciples heard what had happened, they came to get his body and buried it in a tomb. And the apostles returned to Jesus from their ministry tour and told him all that had been done and taught. And then Jesus said, let's go off by ourselves to a quiet place and rest a while. I just want to stop there and say, you know, Jesus, when you think about Jesus in his humanity, he's God in the flesh, but he's in humanity, so he got tired. He got, you know, in a sense, man, his cousin was just beheaded. He's been rejected by his hometown people, right? And he's dealing with this, and he tells the guys, they come back, and they're, oh, man, I want to tell you about what happened. And he's like, hey, guys, we need to get away for a while. And just in the midst of this, I just saw this as just a real quick example of when you're following Jesus, you are not exempt from loss in your life. You're not exempt from loss in this life. That doesn't mean everything's going to go well and that everything's going to work out fine and that you're not going to lose loved ones and lose jobs and lose position, those kinds of things. There's a sense of loss that is a part of our life. And so you got to break through that. Now, this is the one where I just want to say, because we're human, it's a struggle. And I know there's times when I see people in loss, they're mourning a loss in their life, and I just kind of want them to just like break through that, just get over it. You know, God has a great plan for you. All things work together for good. And that person, I can tell, they want to just slug me right in the throat. So I've learned not to say those things out loud, right? So, but it's like I want to understand that loss in life is the reality of our lives, and to come alongside someone and just pray with them and love on them. You know, I loved what Chrissy was saying about our homeless neighbors. You know, sometimes we want to fix it and say, hey, just da da da. You know, sometimes it's just about coming alongside and loving on someone and helping them, to encourage them. You know, those kinds of things. And then, you know, help them take some steps if possible, but come alongside. And I just thought of this. John the Baptist, when he was in prison before he got beheaded, he sent some guys to Jesus and said, hey, they came to Jesus and they said, hey, John's wondering, are you the guy? Right? John's the one that said, that's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, right? That's the one. He's the one you should follow. Less of me, more of him, all that. But he's in prison. He's getting, you know, in that pain moment of his life. He sends his guys to Jesus. Hey, just want to make sure you're the Messiah. And Jesus says, hey, guys, go tell John the things that are happening. The blind are seeing. The deaf are hearing. Miracles are happening. But if even John can have a time of doubt and discouragement and wondering if it's really Jesus, so can you and I. Loss. Don't be afraid of it. Don't deny it. Be ready to walk through it and let Jesus walk you through it. And it's a season. It's a time. Let him walk you through it. Don't be afraid of it. I hear so many people when they're going through a loss time, they're like, I just need to be strong. No, you don't. He's strong. You're not that strong. It's okay. The fear of loss, which leads us to the third one, which is following Jesus, pushes you to face the fear of limitations. Fear of limitations. It says late in the afternoon, and starting in verse 35, late in the afternoon, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place and it's already getting late." So he said, "Let's get away." But all these people showed up. And all of a sudden, there's this big crowd. They're following, you know, want to see what's going on. They want to see what Jesus is going to say. And the disciples say, "Hey, we're out in the middle of nowhere here. We should send these people away because we don't have enough for them to eat, right? So send the crowds away so that they can go to the nearby farms and villages to buy something to eat." And Jesus says, "You feed them." Right? They're coming to tell him, "Hey, all these people, we can't, you know, we need to let them go so they can go get something to eat." "Well, you feed them." The disciples like, "With what?" "Well, what do you got? What do you got?" Right? That's the question. Jesus said, "You feed them. You do this. You get involved in ministry. You take that step of faith." And you're like, "What? I don't have enough. I don't have enough. I'm limited. I don't have enough." And he's like, "Well, what do you got? Find out what we got." So what did they come back with? Oh, well, they went out and they surveyed the crowd and they came back and they found a few loaves and fishes, right? Just a little bit. "We have 5 loaves and a bread and 2 fish." And this wasn't like loaves of bread, like, you know, this was like some flat bread and a couple little fishes. It's probably like enough for a fish taco. That was about half the size of the one you get at Taco Nazo, okay? So it's like, this is it. So Jesus didn't go, "What? What do you expect me to do with that? Like, this is it? All these people, and that's all you found. What is wrong with you guys?" No, he's like, "Okay. All right, everybody sit down. Get everybody to sit down in groups. Give me some, okay. Sir, let me pray. We'll pass it out." The disciples are like, "Okay, let's see what happens with this." Right? How much did it take? Not much. Was it enough? More than enough. For over 5,000 people, it says 5,000 men. So you know if there were 5,000 men, there were a bunch of women and a lot of children. So it was a huge crowd. And here's what I realized. When I realize I don't have enough stuff to meet the need, Jesus says, and here's your blank, fill this in. I want you to write this down. When you realize you do not have enough stuff, I want you to hear Jesus say, "Sit down and watch me work. Sit down, watch me work." What are you so afraid of that you don't have enough? You don't have enough time, talent, treasure, whatever that is you don't have enough of. You don't need enough. You need to use what you have, give it to Jesus, and let him multiply it. Right? So they totally got that lesson. And immediately in Mark chapter 6, starting in verse 45, immediately after this, Jesus insisted that his disciples get back in the boat and head across to the Bethsaida while he sent the people home. After telling everyone goodbye, he went up to the hills by himself to pray. Late that night, the disciples were in their boat in the middle of the lake, and Jesus was alone on the land. Okay, so here we go. Immediately after all that, Jesus says, "Okay, guys, get in the boat. Go head over to Bethsaida. I'll meet you over there. I'm going to tell the people to go home. Now that they're full and fed and all that, I'm going to tell them to go home. Then I'm going to go up. I'll meet you over there." Which they have no idea what that means, right? "I'll meet you over there." So they get in the boat. They start rowing across the Sea of Galilee, the Lake of Galilee. And he goes up on the mountainside and begins to pray. It says, late that night, the disciples were in their boat in the middle of the lake, and Jesus was alone on the land. He saw that they were in serious trouble, rowing hard and struggling against the winds and the wave. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them, walking on the water. It says he intended to go past them, but when they saw him walking on the water, they cried out in terror, thinking he was a ghost. They were all terrified when they saw him, but Jesus spoke to them at once. "Don't be afraid," he said. "Take courage. I am here." Can you imagine? I mean, again, we're talking about these guys are, a lot of them are fishermen. Not all of them are. So you know the accountant, the tax collector, he's freaking out. They're out in the middle of the lake. They're rowing. You know, they're going across. And Jesus said, "I'll meet you on the other side." So there, it says they were out there rowing and struggling against the winds and the waves. And Jesus is up there praying on the mount. What is he praying for? Them. And what do you think they're yelling at each other 9 hours, 3 o'clock in the morning? That was 9 hours from when they started rowing. They're in the middle of this storm, rowing like crazy and really not getting anywhere. They are struggling and not getting anywhere. And do you think that any of those guys mentioned that Jesus wasn't with them? I do. Where's Jesus? You know, last time he was with us, man, he shut this whole thing down. Where's he now? He must not care about us. All of a sudden they look out and they see him walking on the water. And it says they're terrified. They think it's a ghost. And it says he was going to pass them by, but he doesn't. And he says, guys, it's me. I'm here. This is the part where, in another gospel, where Peter gets out of the boat. We're not going to get into that today. But when I realize I don't have enough strength, here's what I want you to get. When I realize I don't have enough strength to go on, Jesus walks up and says this, and I want you to write this in here. Don't be afraid. I am here. Don't be afraid. I am here. Not only does Jesus expose our limits with stuff to meet the needs, he exposes our physical limits of strength. When we get to the point of exhaustion, we give all, everything we have, and we get nowhere. Then we see Jesus walking up saying, I'm right here with you. Don't be afraid. Let's keep going. Didn't Jesus say, go to Bethsaida and I'll meet you there? Yeah. That's where they're going. In the middle, though, huge storm, a lot of fear. Jesus walks into that storm and fear and says, I'm right here. 2 Corinthians 9:8 says, God is able to make all grace abound to you so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. Now all glory to God, Ephesians 3:20, who is able through his mighty power at work within us to accomplish infinitely more than we would ask or think. Isaiah 40:31, our theme verse for the year, but those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. We need to make a decision today. We're going to follow Jesus, but we're going to need to make a decision today. Totally opposite of the decision the people in Nazareth made about Jesus. He is the Messiah. He is your Savior. So the decision today is accept him as your Lord and Savior. Let him come into your life. Take over. Yeah, he's going to scare you with some things. He's going to take you in some scary spots. But he is your Lord and Savior. It is a relationship with Jesus that not only saves you eternally, but leads you practically, day by day, step by step, right now, through the rejection, through the loss, through any limitation. I want you to bow your head and pray with me. Sometimes in our lives, we feel like giving up. Maybe you're there. Let me tell you, if you feel like giving up, do it. Give it up. Give it up to God. Surrender to God. Give all your fears, all your failures, all your doubts, all your praises, all your victories, everything. Give it up, surrendered fully to Jesus. Because it's when we surrender fully to Jesus, rather than surrendering to the fear we face, we grow and we become what he wants us to become. We go where he wants us to go. We step out and we become missional in our community and all around the planet. We don't let fear run our lives without our faith in Jesus. Be the base, the foundation, the anchor. So today, in response, I just want to ask you, have you given your life to Jesus? Have you given your situation to Jesus? Have you surrendered all to Jesus? I'm going to pray, and Matt's going to lead us in a song called To Be Like You. And it basically says, Lord Jesus, I just want to surrender my life to you. And we're going to have people up here that will pray with you if you want to come up and respond in prayer. But let's totally surrender to Jesus today. Break through every fear. God, we pray that you would draw us closer into a personal, powerful relationship with you. God, we thank you for your presence, especially in the midst of a storm. God, when we're looking around trying to find where you're at and what you want us to do, God, that you are right there. Open our eyes, open our hearts. God, help us to be a people who want more of you and less of ourselves, and to really surrender to that. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, why don't you stand with me? Response team will be up front here. Come on up. If you want to pray, come on up. We'd love to pray with you.
All I need is more of you.
All right, thanks for being here today. I want to extend a special thank you to Chris from Habitat for being here today. And Chrissy and the team from KCB, Kingdom Causes Bellflower, thank you guys for being here today. And Chris is going to be out under one of thank you for not getting me wet, and that I'm still conscious, okay? So there's coins in these envelopes. That's, you know, that's awesome. Okay, Matt, you get to pick up all these envelopes. Where's, okay, cool, okay. All right, so we're ready for the Super Bowl party, right? Okay, anyways, let me just say this. If you're a guest today, you can have a bath like this too. Now, if you're a guest today, if you head out that way or that way, go to the gazebo or out in the front, we have t-shirts for you. So fill out that guest card. We'd love to hang out with you for a few minutes. So make sure and do that. We've got cake pops. We got Chris is going to be out under the tent to talk about Habitat if you got questions about that. So a lot of things going on. Make sure and check it out. Thanks for being here today. God bless you. Have an awesome week.